Welcome to Southern Sense Talk Radio with your host, the radio chick, Annie Ubelis. Join Annie on Tuesdays and Fridays at 2 p.m. Eastern Time with an open chat room full of her regulars. And yes, you can even call in. Call 917-889-3675. That's 917-889-3675 to be a part of the action on the phone line. Not able to listen live? Not a problem. You can always catch Annie, the radio chick, and Southern Sense Talk Radio podcast in archives at southern-sense.com. So sit back, relax, and enjoy Southern Sense the right way.
O'clock in the afternoon, and where are you? You are here on Southern Sense, here on Blog Talk Radio, SHR Media, High Plains Media, Kinetic Hi-Fi, The Fix FM, out of Charleston, South Carolina, as well as Spreaker, Stitcher, iTunes, Patriot, American Radio, or something like that. I forget which. I'm your hostess with the mostest, the radio chick, Annie, along with my debonair and oh-so-cool co-host, Curtis C.S. Bennett. Good afternoon, Curtis.
How are you, Annie, today?
Oh, I'm doing fine. I'm doing fine. It looks like my guest is calling in on my cell phone.
Oh, God.
But it never fails. It never fails. So, Curtis, do me a favor. Take over while I take care of this. Hang on.
All right. Well, we're fighting back the rain clouds here in Florida. Hopefully, we'll have a lot of sunshine coming in today from our guests, and I know we will. I understand he's from Alaska, but he's going to bring some of that California sunshine our way, since that's the place he was born, I understand. We're hoping that everybody's looking forward to this weekend. Independence Day is Monday, and I hope everybody understands the meaning of what it is to be liberated from England. I hope our children are learning this in school. I am dubious, but I am hopeful. And as far as former President Bill Clinton and his little meeting, because that seemed to be the topic of the day, his meeting with the current Attorney General, hopefully it'll work in our favor, you know, whatever goes down with that. But I would have to say that I really think that was planned. I think it was a calculated move on Bill's part, but that's just the way the Clintons play. You know, they play for keeps. So he knew what he was doing. So, but hopefully, like I said, we can get this woman indicted, get somebody in there like Trump to turn this country around, and we get back on the road to prosperity, and we get people back to work.
That's a huge amen to that, Curtis. Thanks for filling in. We got so much to talk about and so much that's been going on. Before we really do start the show, I want to make a small little call out there. And as much as I do not like the Huffington Post, I found them to be the best for this resource. Everyone knows about the floods in West Virginia, and now the death toll is up to, I think, 23 or 24. There's sites out there, and if you go onto our show page, and below the chat is a comment, and you'll see two comments, one for the Huffington Post link, which links a lot of good places where you can go and make donations or volunteer your time or send resources such as something as simple as dog food and diapers. So check out the Huffington Post link on this page, as well as Samaritan's Purse, where they're also looking for people to volunteer, to hand out food, to help with the cleanup, to help with the construction, as well as monetary donations. Two great links there if you want to help the victims of the West Virginia flood. It is devastating and it has been called a disaster area. So again, I urge you, if not during the show, after the show, when the chat room closes, just look at the comments below the description, click on the links, and see what you can do to help your fellow Americans that are hurting and in need. That said, as we move on. Those that listen to the show know that we start off each and every show with a dedication. And about quarter after the hour, we will have our guest, Doug Briney, calling in. He was calling on my cell phone, Curtis. I love it when my guests mix up the cell phone with the show number. But we do a dedication to a fallen hero, and today is no different. And once again, I am sad to do this dedication to a fellow law enforcement officer. Today's dedication is going to go out to Agent Gilberto Colón-Leon at a Puerto Rico Police Department, Puerto Rico. His end of watch was this past Monday, June 13th. And as I look for my dedication, and let's bring that music up, and bear with me because I had to reload everything. This dedication is going to start off just a little bit differently. And it starts off with a poem called I'm Just Like You. The author is unknown. I have been where you fear to be. I have seen what you fear to see. I have done what you fear to do. All these things I have done for you. I'm the one you lean upon, the one you cast your scorn upon, the one you bring your troubles to. All these things I have been for you. The one you ask to stand apart. The one you feel should have no heart. The one you call the man in blue. But I am a person just like you. And through the years, I have come to see that I am not what you ask of me. So take this badge and take this gun. Will you take it? Will anyone? And when you watch a person die, and hear a battered baby cry, then do you think that you can be all these things you ask of me? This is from Officer Down Memorial Page, which you can find at odmp.org. Agent Gilberto Colón Leon, Puerto Rico Police Department, age 51, tour of duty, 19 years, 8 months. Badge number 25965. Cause of death, gunfire. Date of incident, June 13, 2016. Weapon used, handgun. Suspect info, charged with murder. It doesn't say a heck of a lot, but it does say Agent Gilberto Colón Leon was shot and killed when he took action during a robbery attempt while off duty at approximately 2 a.m. He was taking a friend home when multiple subjects approached them at the intersection of Calle Santiago Ingleses and Calle Ruiz Belvias in Cuomo and attempted to rob them. Agent Colón Leon was shot multiple times when he attempted to draw his weapon and take action. The subjects fled the scene after shooting him, but were arrested approximately 2 weeks later and charged with murder. He was in the department for almost 20 years and was assigned to the Highway Division. He survived by his wife and 2 children. Here an officer off duty, taking a friend home, leaving behind a wife and 2 children. We ask so much of our men and women in law enforcement and never give them the respect and honor they are due. This is also from an unknown author entitled, When God Made Peace Officers. When the Lord was creating peace officers, he was into his 6th day of overtime. And when an angel appeared and said, you're doing a lot of fiddling around on this one. And the Lord said, have you read the specs on this order? A peace officer has to be able to run 5 miles through the alleys in the dark, scale walls, enter homes the health inspector won't touch, and not wrinkle his uniform. He has to be able to sit in an undercover car all day on a stakeout, cover a homicide scene that night, and canvass the neighborhood for witnesses and testify in court the next day. He has to be in top physical condition at all times, running on black coffee and half-eaten meals, and he has to have 6 pairs of hands. The angel shook her head slowly and said, 6 pairs of hands? No way. Not the hands that are causing me problems, the Lord said. It's the 3 pairs of eyes an officer has to have. That's on a standard model, the angel asked. The Lord nodded. 1 pair that sees through a bulge in a pocket before he asks, may I see what's in there, sir? when he already knows and wishes he'd taken the accounting job. Another pair here on the side of his head for his partner's safety, and another pair of eyes here in the front that can look reassuringly at a bleeding victim and say, "You'll be all right, ma'am," when he knows it isn't so. "Lord," said the angel, touching his sleeve, "rest and work on this tomorrow." "I can't," said the Lord. "I already have a model that can talk a 250-pound drunk into a patrol car without incident and feed a family of five on a civil service paycheck." The angel circled the model of the peace officer very slowly. "Can it think?" she asked. "You bet," said the Lord. "It can tell you the elements of 100 crimes, recite Miranda rights in its sleep, detain, investigate, search, and arrest a gang member on the streets in less time it takes five learned judges to debate the legality of the stop, and it still keeps its sense of humor. This officer has phenomenal personal control. He can deal with crime scenes painted in hell, coax a confession from a child abuser, comfort a murder victim's family, and read in the daily paper how law enforcement isn't sensitive to the right of criminal suspects." Finally, the angel bent over and rang her finger across the cheek of the police officer. "There's a leak," she pronounced. "I told you we're trying to put too much into this model." "That's not a leak," the Lord said. "It's a tear." "What's the tear for?" the angel asked. "It's for bottled up emotions, for fallen comrades, for commitment to that funny piece of cloth called the American flag, for justice." "You're a genius," said the angel. The Lord looked somber. "I didn't put it that there," he said. "Today's show is dedicated to all my fellow law enforcement officers who have served and who are serving, as well as to our military, the men and women we asked to do so much, the men that have served and women who are serving and those who will serve. God bless them all."
I fought for my liberty. I paid with the blood of my people. Freedom has never been free. Now my door's always open to dreamers and friends. When I'm attacked, I protect and defend. I stand for my respect for humanity. Now I'm challenged by tyrants who envy my power, but their vicious deeds become my finest hour. Because my name is America, I stand for. I always be here. For those who will harm me, I'll face without fear. But I'll always stand proud and free. I'm America, don't tread on me.
My name is America, and you can download that song for free by going to his website, toddallenshow.com. You're here listening to Southern Sense here on Blog Talk Radio, High Plains Media, SHR Media, Kinetic Hi-Fi, The Fix FM, out of Charleston, South Carolina, half a dozen other places. Just go to my website, which is the name of the show, put a dash in the middle, southern-sense.com. Check it out. And we're still sitting at number 16 at the top 100 conservative shows at toptalkradio.com. All on our website. Check out southern-sense.com. I'm your hostess with the mostest, the radio chick Annie, along with my oh-so-prolific author and co-host, Curtis C.S. Bennett. Curtis, ready to rock and roll?
I'm ready.
All right. We've got a fantastic guest returning. He has been with us. I can't believe he's been a guest with us now for 4 years running. He has gone from obscure little singer and pastor in Alaska now to an award-winning country music star. Let's bring back the one, the only, the oh-so-hunk of the year, Doug Briney. Good afternoon, Doug.
Well, thank you, Eddie. The hunk of the year. That's a brand-new title.
You know, it really is interesting because the first time that you and I had an interview, it was just before your first album came out, and we were promoting some of the shows on that first album. Believe it or not, It's All Country back in 2012, and oh my goodness, what a road you have traveled in those 4 years, and I'm so proud to have been on that road with you.
Well, it has been an incredible journey, and we're nowhere near the end of the road, we hope. You know, I feel like we're just really starting to get some traction. I think we've gotten off the dirt trails and the dirt road, and I think we're actually on some blacktop now, and before long I'm hoping that we're getting to the interstate and get this thing really moving.
It's just amazing that you've been traveling, and I've been following it. Believe it or not, you know, I get your email updates. I do follow the site and check out what you're doing. Because the last time you were on, you were promoting that Parkinson song, if I remember correctly, which was last year. Yeah. So it's been a little bit of a while since you've been on.
Yeah, and Parkinson's is still doing very well. The National Parkinson's Foundation picked that up and been doing real well with that. It's been exciting, but yeah, it has been a little while. I think when I was, even as we were doing Parkinson's song, getting ready with that, we were in the process of really mapping out what the brand new project was going to be like put together a country gospel album, started working on that in September, signed with Winter Records actually, it was the end of October, but we signed at the end of November. We jumped ahead because both of us were going to be out of town at that time that we wanted to sign. So we post-dated the contract and then got in the studio in January and February, got in the studio and started working on that. And then we just put the brand-new project out. May 28th was the release date for it. And thrilled with it. It's called Songs of Faith, and thrilled with it. The current single that's out on there is Touch One Life, and getting some great reviews with it. And it's an exciting thing.
Oh, it is. It is. And I was listening to it last night, and I was making some notes furiously. So be prepared.
All right.
You have a lot of also charity work that you do. And one of them is Bright Star International, as well as Operation Troop Aid. Tell us about that. And there's a new one you put on the very bottom of your page. You snuck it in on me. Beards for Veterans. What is that one?
Yeah, Operation Troop Aid, first of all, is headed up out of here, out of Nashville. The gentleman who heads that up is a veteran himself, a combat veteran, and he puts together care packages and sends to our troops. He also works closely with the veterans, different veterans groups, to get them aid in where they need it. But it's primarily set up for active duty military, to give them a little taste of home, to help support them. He sends a lot of care packages over and does that, but also very big into connecting returning soldiers with the resources that they need with, post-traumatic stress disorder and even helping fight the red tape with the VA and the nightmare that can sometimes be, being an advocate for them and help connecting them with the correct people who can speed along that miserable process and all of that. So that's Operation Troop Aid. Bright Star International has been a fantastic organization, just working on, they connect me when I'm doing some concerts in an area. They'll connect me with a charitable organization, and I always do with the military group. My Beards group, I was contacted by a good friend of mine up in Anchorage, Alaska, who connected with a gentleman down in Soldotna, Alaska, who has started Beards for Veterans, and he himself is a veteran. And what he is doing is taking a lot of these veterans who have post-traumatic stress disorder. He is taking them out on the rivers, on fishing trips. They can have some physical challenges as well. They may be an amputee or even a double amputee. But he takes them out on the rivers there and lets them do some fishing, and some of the best fishing in the world. He takes them out on different hunts and allows them some time just around a campfire, growing the beard out around the campfire, on a week at a time or 2 weeks sometimes at a time, just to sit and talk and to debrief with someone else who has been there. And he we got in contact through a mutual friend and got in contact with him said, man, anything I can do to support you, I'm all over that. And so he's been real good about promoting the music there, and he uses my CDs as they're out in there. Actually, he uses the MP3 versions while they're out in the wild, and lets them know that there's some folks that still care about our veterans and that really really support them. And so those are the three main organizations that I work with real close, as well as Parkinson's.
Doug, I find it so heartwarming that you're able to use your faith and the power of your songs with these veterans, especially since so many of these men and women are coming back and being told that while they're on active duty, they could not display their faith. They couldn't carry the Bible or proselytize or anything like that. They had to keep their mouth shut, total line. So at least now they've got somewhere to express themselves and vent. Go ahead, Curtis. It's such a wonderful thing you're doing, Doug.
Curtis.
Thank you for the work he's done on behalf of veterans and everything. I'm a veteran myself, and I really appreciate it. You're a pastor, from what I understand, and you began a church called the Cowboy Church of Anchorage. Can you tell our listening audience how that came about and how you got the name Cowboy Church?
Sure. Well, it really came out of my lifestyle. I'm a definitely cowboy at heart, and I'm honest with folks. I know my way around the backside of an animal and how to do some of those things, but I really come at the cowboy lifestyle more from the music side of it. Country music has always been my genre. That's what I grew up listening to. All my influences, pretty much all of my influencers are country. And so I had been pastoring in Alaska, was up in Talkeetna, Alaska for 4 years. We moved back into Anchorage and wanted to start a church. We were getting ready. We felt like God was calling us to start a church, and we were looking around and doing some different things, making some plans and trying to figure out where and how, and really seeking God out through prayer and what he would have us do. And I entered a competition up in Anchorage with a local radio station there, Country Idol, and had a lot of fun with that. We met in the bars, and I met a lot of people that were singing country music that were loyal listeners to that radio station. And it was through that that I really became, hey, here's a whole group of people I identify with that identify with me. And that time, there was not a single church anywhere in Alaska that was using country music as the main genre. Now, we still sang the praise music, the modern praise music, but we countryfied everything. So that's how it came about, seeing that need and God laying that need upon my heart and being out there with the folks. And so it was a great opportunity, and we started then the Cowboy Church, and it was there in Anchorage. And so we were not real original in our naming. It was very simple, the Cowboy Church of Anchorage, and that's how that came about. And we bring in saddles and cowhide, we split rail fence, we had bull whips, we had a branding iron. We'd bring in the Western decor each week. I preached with jeans, hat, cowboy boots, and you know, full Western gear every week, and most of our folks came to church that way. It was a part of their lifestyle and who they were, and so it was a great fit.
I like the
concept. It is an absolutely wonderful concept, and you've carried that over here to Tennessee, where you're now a pastor in the First Baptist Church in Old Hickory, Tennessee.
Correct. I serve as on staff as the associate pastor there, which is great because I'm able to be there most of the time during the weeks, and working and getting things prepared for weekends. And I'm not in the pulpit, so I'm able to get out on the weekends and be in other churches and doing the concerts and doing that type of thing. So it works real well.
All right. Well, I've got one bone to pick with the Baptists here. Why
all
is
right.
it my favorite hymn, How Great Thou Art, every single time I hear someone sing it or record it at the Baptist, they leave out the third verse. What's wrong with the third verse?
Absolutely nothing. I think most of the time it's a timing issue. I know it comes back. I don't know. I don't think it's a Baptist thing. I think it's because we sing the third verse in church, but when I can tell you for the recording, most radio stations want the songs between 2 minutes and 30 seconds, and at the longest, 3 minutes and 30 seconds. That's the typical play time for songs. Typically, 2 minutes and 30 seconds to 3 minutes is more your average. And How Great Thou Art, you sing verses one, even if you just sing verses one, three, and four, you're over that marker, and most radio stations won't play it. And so it's a practical thing. I can tell you it's a practical thing. And on the album there, the brand new project I did verses one and four. And it was simply because I felt like verse four is, you know, the celebration really in that, but it is, it's a practical thing. I say that, and we threw practicality out the window on a couple of the songs. Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone, I threw practicality completely out the window. I think that's close to a 5.5 minute, almost a 6 minute song. But we're not going to promote that song to radio. Is part of it, and so it's one of those things. Yeah, we're hoping to be able to do How Great Thou Art to radio.
Well, I'm going to play that, but I love the history behind the song. And the first time I heard the history of it was from my preacher in the pulpit about Reverend Carl mm-hmm. Gustav Boberg, who was hiking on the side of the mountain and got stuck in the thunderstorm. And during that thunderstorm, he was so amazed with the beauty and glory of God's creation. He wrote the first verse, put it aside, and it was several years later he finally was able to complete the song because the first verse just awed him so much. He didn't know what to do. So he just waited for God to tell him what to write for the rest of it.
And I have broke into that song a couple different times just looking at God's creation. One of the most memorable times ever. I was in Talkeetna, Alaska. It was about 2 o'clock in the morning on in the middle of winter, temperature probably around negative 10, negative 15. And we were out. Talkeetna doesn't have city lights, but we were way out. We rode snow machines to the top of a ridge, and we were looking over the entire Alaska range. So we had Denali, and we had just all the beauty there, and the northern lights were out like crazy, dancing all around us, and it was a bright, bright display. Multiple colors, gorgeous. And I couldn't help but to sing, "How Great Thou Art."
Oh, man. Well, this is your song from your new album, Song of Praise, "How Great Thou Art." Hoping it's playing. Come on, play. Oh, come on. This is not going to do this to me. Do not do this to me, guys. Come on.
Technical difficulties.
Here we go.
There it is.
Oh Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, I pass
fantastic. Absolutely fantastic.
Oh, thank you.
Well,
thank
it was,
any
was,
one
was,
of the
so,
things. Go ahead.
Go ahead. Go ahead, Doug.
I was just going to say thank you very much. One of the things I really strived for on this entire project, because we took outside of three songs that are more modern, Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone, You Are My King, Amazing Love, Touch When Life Course is the original, and then I guess I Will Rise. So we had 4 out of 10 songs that are a little bit more modern. But what we did is we took a lot of these old songs that my grandmother listened to that that I had grown up with. And what we wanted to do is make them stay true to the song, but we wanted to make them fresh so that kids that are listening to country music today and kids that are in church today, as well as our older generation, would listen to it, and they wouldn't think immediately, well, that's what grandma listened to. So many times you hear some of these older songs and they're recorded the same way, I feel like, that would have been recorded back when my grandmother was listening to them. And we tried to bring them a little bit more current sound, but stay true to the song. And so it means a lot that you all are enjoying it.
Well, you know, there's a couple of songs on your album that do fall into that, such as the Patsy Cline and Willie Nelson version of Just a Closer Walk. You also have the one that Sister Rosetta Tharpe made public, famous. She did two versions. She did one that was a folk and one that was like sort of like a pre-rock version called This Train. So there are a couple that, you know, people, you've taken from what they've done and you've actually taken it a step further. But people don't realize that, you know, you started singing like a lot of other musicians in church, but your first solo was at the age of 2. That is phenomenal, the age of 2. I mean, I watch on Sunday when they bring these kids in Sunday school forward to do their little songs, and half of them can't remember the first phrase, much less whether they can wave their hand or not. And here at the age of 2, you're soloing.
Yeah, it was, and I think I've shared this story with you before. My dad has a reel-to-reel tape, an old reel-to-reel tape, and he has the tape of me doing that in church, and the song that I sang was called He. I still can remember most of the words to that, but it's kind of funny. My voice at 2 years old, it sounded like the old Little Rascals character, Froggy. It just, it was this deep voice coming out of it. It was a deeper voice coming out of a little 2-year-old kid. And then, but yeah, I've been in church my entire life and have grew up singing in church, grew up leading worship with our youth group that I grew up in, and went to college, Baptist Bible College for music degree, and church and songs of faith are definitely a huge part of my life.
That they are, and so a lot of people are starting, I think, to come back. I noticed that in my church, I'm seeing more and more people starting to come. I think because of the crisis we have going on, they finally realize we can't turn to the government and we can't turn to the Hollywood and the media because they're not giving us answers. And I'm just hoping I'm looking at it the right way, and I do see people returning.
You know, I pray that they are. It's really interesting. I think it very much depends upon the churches. I see some churches that are absolutely struggling just to keep the doors open, and then I see some of the churches that are really thriving. I can say the church that we're at, that I'm at here as associate, we really are a merger of two churches that have come together. Both churches were struggling, but together we've become very strong, and we are really starting to see some growth happen. But it's a very concerted effort. It's really a humbling of yourself before God and not trying to follow a program, but really to be obedient to whatever God is asking you to do. And so there's some churches that are doing really well, and there's some who are really struggling. And I'd like to believe that there's a lot of folks turning back and turning to God through the crises that we're going through some of these things. But what I am seeing more and more is a divisiveness in our nation, and turning to where they're not necessarily turning to politics, they're turning to a person rather than God to try and fix their problems, and that troubles me, because anytime we start turning to a person rather than our creator, I think we're in bad shape.
Well, you know, the perfect song to follow that up in is In the Garden. And this was written by an author by C. Austin Mills. And his story is really, really interesting. For those that don't know it, he was actually a photographer. He was in his studio in the darkroom. And he just sort of went into a trance. And throughout the entire night, he had this vision, which once he came out of the trance and woke up, he wrote it and then wrote this song. And what you do with it, because I was listening to some of the more contemporary versions of it, and it's very calming, it's very staid, but you use a device in there, and I'm going to call it the pregnant pause. And I think it's very, very powerful the way you do it.
Well, thank you. I'll tell you right from the get-go that my musicians, that was one of the hardest things that was the hardest thing that we had to do the entire time, because we had the pregnant pause there, but we changed tempo completely during that pause, and we had to come back in. And I'll tell you, the drummer on this project is a good friend of mine. His name is Billy Mason. Billy Mason was Tim McGraw's drummer for 18 and a half years. The steel guitar player in here plays for Big and Rich. The keyboard player has played on the Grand Ole Opry for over 30 years. Tim Atwood, the guitar player is Grayson, who is a phenomenal Australian artist and probably one of the best guitar players here in Nashville. I had some incredible musicians, and they were all just, we were all sweating bullets on that pregnant pause, making sure that everything came in correctly. So I'm glad that you enjoy it, and I'm going to pass that on to all of them and let them know, hey, this was worth it.
And I can imagine you standing there counting 1, 2, 3, 4, now.
Yeah, it was really interesting because they had never done that before. None of them had ever done it quite like that before. And so it was a learning curve for all of us. It really was.
Well, this is track 3 from your album, Songs of Faith, and the song is called The Train.
I come to the garden alone while the dew.
love that slide guitar there. Love it.
Yeah. he was, man, he is so impressive. The steel guitar player who plays with me normally is incredible. And I found out him and Brain is just blanking on his name. I want to say Jason, and that is not right. But my steel guitar player and him are really close friends. And I was thrilled to know that because Cody was listening to it. He says, "Oh yeah, that's the little slide I taught him, and yeah, he taught me this one, and yeah, he's phenomenal."
You know, it's an amazing album, and I'm enjoying it a lot. And I got to tell you, ironically, 1 hour before airtime, the U.S. Postal Delivery delivered your CD. So I got to thank you. That last night you sent me the Dropbox, and I was able to drop everything onto a CD, so I had it already loaded up. But it came in.
Yeah,
so I've got it in my fat little hand.
I came back. I was out in Virginia for a week. I came back from Virginia. I got back on Friday evening. It was about 9:30. I got to spend some time with my family before everybody went to bed. Saturday, my wife and I had a ton of errands that we had to get done together and some shopping, and got that done. At 2:00 in the afternoon, I took off on the motorcycle and went down to North Georgia Speedway and sang the national anthem there. So it was about three and a half hour ride to get there. I sang the national anthem, stayed for several hours of the racing, and then turned around and I got home at about 1 a.m. Sunday morning, went to church. Washed all my clothes, packed everything back up, and then on Monday morning we left for a youth missions trip up in Indianapolis, Indiana. And I got home Saturday then at about 1 in the afternoon. Tried to get everything set for Sunday. Got everything ready and got into the office on Monday. Monday and Tuesday, it was crazy because I didn't get a chance to do anything that was on my agenda. It was all catching up, and I was like, I've got to get to the post office. And so I ran over there and stuck it in the post office and got it sent out. So I'm glad that it got there for you. But I started thinking, oh, if they don't get this thing delivered on time, I'm in trouble. And after them losing that first one that I sent out, I didn't have a whole lot of faith that it would get there. So I thought, I'll send the link to the Dropbox and we'll be safe.
Well, you know, I got to tell you a little secret, because about an hour before you sent me the Dropbox, I had already gone onto Amazon and downloaded. I bought it on Amazon. I had not downloaded it yet. And then your email came through, and I said, all right, I'll take care of Amazon later on because I want to make sure it goes onto all my computers. Let me do the Dropbox, put it onto the CD. Now I'm not going to have to worry about it. But this way, now I've got the CD. I've got it back up. And if the other one comes in the mail eventually, probably around Christmas time, I will give it away to a listener.
There we go. Perfect. Man, it's one of those things where just like you said in the email back and forth, it's just another example of our, you know, I think our government workers really try, but it's a system that's in place, and man, it fails us so often, and we see that with our military, we see that with the VA, we see that in every aspect where the government tries to get bigger and take over things, it's a system that fails.
Yeah. Hey, Doug.
Yes, sir.
It's a powerful medium for reaching people. And I know you're reaching a lot of people with your music. Now, when it comes to helping people, that requires money. You once owned a business, and I believe it was called the Cowboy Coffee Shack. Have you ever thought about opening up a chain to raise funds to assist your ministry?
Curtis, before he answers that, Doug, before you answer this, Cool Mike, who you know used to be my co-host, and he interviewed you with me on several of our shows just as you were coming up, And he sent me a private message reminding me that one of your first interviews, you had that coffee shop up in Alaska. And as we were doing the interview, you were manning the drive-up window, and we can hear the bells digging in the background as you were making people coffee and handing it to them through the window.
Yep. I remember that real well. You know, Curtis, I would love to start. I actually was having a conversation with when we first moved to Nashville. I went to work at a local coffee shop here called Uncommon Grounds. It was Jacob's Well at the time, but Uncommon Grounds, and went to work for them. And then the owner actually ended up really sick for about 3 months. That I was it. I was the cook, the bottle washer, the shopper. Wow. It was like running my own business again. And so I'm in there quite a bit. And I was just in there the other day, and we were talking. He's looking at making some changes to his business, and I was sharing with him. I said, you know, I've got this vision in my head of what if I was to ever open up a coffee shop, I would do it this way. And his eyes lit up, and he says, man, that's a great idea. And I said, yeah, I said, but that's my idea. at this time, the demands of opening a business, operating a business, it really is a 24-hour, 7-day
full-time
week.
Job.
It's more than that, because you really are. You're there at the business all the time. You have to do all the shopping. You're all the maintenance. You're doing everything. And for me to be here in Nashville and trying to do what I'm doing, and to be out on the road, there's no way I could be a owner operator. At this point, down the road, that may be an option. I would love to get, have a real successful coffee shop that then I could franchise and have, four or five locations. That would be phenomenal.
Kenny Rogers Hollywood.
Kenny Rogers did well for a while, but boy, it went south for him at the end. And Toby Keith is discovering that's a difficult thing. Jimmy Buffett, Margaritaville's are probably the most successful that I'm aware of. I mean, there's some others that are out there. B.B. King's is hugely successful.
Mm-hmm.
So it does happen. But
yours is going to be
these guys have. Yeah, these guys are at the point where they're not there doing the daily operation. None of those guys are. And I'm not at the point where I can hire a full team in there. But, down the road, I would love to open up a coffee shop again. Yeah, I'd love to open up another coffee shop. I really would. And I've got some phenomenal marketing ideas and how I would want the place to look and feel. I think would be a very... I think a very marketable idea.
Yeah, it's a lot of work. But it's a lot of hard work. And right now you've got your focus on your music and on your ministry.
Correct.
And those are two
Correct.
Things that are a full-time job, and people don't realize that. You told a funny story, told us a couple of funny stories, but one funny story that brought to mind is how humble you are as a person when you told the story. You talked about walking into the shop, and they had a jukebox going, and as you're walking in, your song was playing. And one of the customers looked up, saw you walk in, recognized you. It wasn't on the jukebox. I think it was on the radio, if I remember correctly. Maybe I got that
radio.
Right or wrong. It was on the radio.
The guy
looked up, and here you come strolling in, and you were absolutely surprised that someone recognized you and even recognized your music.
Yeah, it was... That happened to me. That's happened a couple times now, and it's a very humbling thing. It's always kind of weird. It's humbling and it's kind of a weird thing. You walk in and they're looking and they're like that instance. The guy actually had the CD in his hand. had purchased the CD and had the CD in his hand, and the song was playing. He was playing it for some of the other customers there. And I walked in, and guy looked up, and he did a double take. And, yeah, and it was interesting. but it is interesting. I was, like I said, I was up in Virginia, and there were some folks there that heard me at the restaurant where I was singing, and they came up running up and they said, "Hey, we've bought your CD. You know, would you sign this for us?" And then I was down in Georgia and I was at singing the national anthem at the racetrack, and a little gal came up and to the announcer's booth up there, and she knocked very timidly and said, "Yeah." She says, "I was wondering if I could get his autograph. I've got his CD at home," and you know, it's one of those very humbling things, and it's remarkable when people do recognize you, because it's just strange to me. It's still strange to me, but it is a lot of fun.
No, it's funny because every now and then I do a TV interview or something like that, or talk to the newspaper, and it's usually about local issues. And I was walking out of church one day, and a woman comes up behind me, and she's seen me in church, you know, every week for the last several years. And she looks at me, and she goes, "You're the TV lady." I'm like, "What? I saw you on the news." But I also find it's amazing because I've been doing the show now. Oh, good, my goodness. I can't believe it, Doug, for 6 years now. And every now and then someone will come across me and say, "Oh, I listened to your show. It's great. Thank you." And I'm like, I'm just a little tiny internet podcast. You know, I'm surprised to someone's listening. But people are out there listening to our words. And you do it through your music, and I do it through the talk. But we are out there getting the message out, which is really super important.
It is. That's a great place for me to segue I try and do this every single time, and I don't want it to ever come across that I do it just because I do it, but I do it because it is heartfelt. I really do want to take a minute and say thank you to all the folks that do listen. I want to say thank you to the folks that purchase music and support me. Because I say this all the time, but it really is the truth, and it's meant from every part of my being. If it wasn't for the fans supporting the music, I'd be singing in a shower, and that would be it. And you know, I wouldn't have three projects out. I wouldn't have Parkinson's song out. I wouldn't be enjoying, you know, the success that I have, and getting those tires up on the blacktop now. And it really is all due to folks like you, Annie, to Curtis, and you know, Mike, as he was on there with you, and then the fans that are listening and saying, "Hey, you know what, we like this guy," or, you know, "We like his music, we like what he has to say," and that means the world to me. It really does.
Well, you know what, I'm enjoying with this show, I'm enjoying, you know, getting people like you with your music out there. And every time I have someone that is gifted in talent such as yourself, to me, that is a joy. And I want to thank you for giving me this opportunity and what little I can do to help as much as I can. And people know that the majority of people that listen to show is in the podcast. So as they look at the show description, they can scroll down, go directly to your link to your webpage, which is your name, DougBriney.com, and check out your music. Your music is also up on iTunes, on Amazon. You have some stuff up on Reverb, but it didn't look like it was updated. I don't know if you're going to go back with them, but iTunes and Amazon, the two main places they can get your music from. Go ahead, Curtis.
Doug, your music is usually categorized as positive country. Can you expound on that?
Yeah, you know, the idea of that, I kind of came up with that classification, I guess, because I've been asked a number of times, you know, to classify the music, and I classify it as positive country because I want it to be something that lifts people up. I want it to be something that inspires people to do more, to be better, to be a better parent, to be a better husband, to be a better person all the way around. And so I classify it as positive country. It's definitely country, but it's not woe is me, you know, drinking my blues away, I love the song Montgomery. I don't know why I like the song so much, but I love, there's a Montgomery Gentry song called Long Line of Losers, and I love the song. And I do that song on occasion in my concerts or whatnot. But I always preface it by saying, you know, I'm singing the song for you because I like the song, not because it has anything to do with my life. And I sure pray and hope that it has nothing to do with your life. But I try and sing songs that elevate people rather than elevate wrong type lifestyles, you know, and things that I just don't believe would be honoring to God.
Well, you know, that said, the leading song for this conversation should be The Train. And as I said before, Sister mm-hmm. Rosetta Tharpe made this very
yes.
famous. She first did it as a country, a folk country song, and then she did it with something you would call pre-rock. But you got to remember, that was a time period of the 50s where there was a revival of Christian music. And I cannot remember the name of the Catholic nun that did the Our Father that became so famous and went to number one. But you did it not exactly rock and not exactly folk. You're more like an Elvis style, I'd call it.
Well, we wanted to have fun with it. I'll tell you who the biggest influence on this song for me was. And I listened to, because this song has been around since the 30s. This song has been around, actually it's been around a little bit longer than that. It was around 1926, 1927 is whenever the song was very first recorded. And so it's been around. It's been recorded by a lot of folks. But the biggest influence on this song for me was Randy Travis. I absolutely loved his version. And well, we didn't want to recreate what he did. We took the feel from what Randy did with this song, and tried to make it our own, but have a lot of fun with it. And again, the whole point to a lot of these older songs was to bring them to a more modern sound where young people today would listen to it, as opposed to thinking just of the grandmother and grandpa when they would listen to it. And we didn't want it to be older church music. We wanted it to be fresh, and that's what we tried to do with it.
Oh, well, yeah, Doug, that it is.
Doug,
go ahead, Chris, before I start playing it.
Okay. Oh, you were a vocal music major. How has that helped technically?
Oh, man, honestly, where to start with that? I sing, you know, 3-4 hour concerts all the time, and I only need to take, sometimes I'll take a 20 minute break. And that's because I'm using proper technique in vocalization. A lot of the training there, breast support, being able to hear, and stay in tune. I don't use auto-tune for those that are listening to the album. There is no auto-tune on this album. None of my albums were auto-tuned. What you hear live is what you hear on the CD. So there's a lot of areas that it has helped. I'm sorry?
Your formal training helped you.
It helps completely in all those areas. Ear, being able to hear pitch correctly, all those things are a big result of the formal training with that.
Good.
Well, I got to say that I do have perfect pitch, except for when I have a couple of scotches in me. And then forget it. Don't even ask me.
Well, I do not have perfect pitch, but I can sing in tune with whatever instrument is playing with me.
And there is a lot. People don't understand when you do go through the formal training of the breath training, of working with your mm-hmm. diaphragm, of timing, getting your lungs to the capacity where you can hold that note long and
right.
to the force you need it to be. And then to be able to project your voice. A lot of musicians rely heavily on the microphone. And you got to think about what you had back in the 20s and 30s. You didn't have the sophisticated equipment. You had to be able to project. And that's something else that comes with the voice training. Phrasing. There's so much complicated things that go into it.
Every area. I'm very grateful for that. And I've said this before, you know, if I had the opportunity to mentor someone and to talk with them, the first bit of advice that I would get them, that if you want to be a guitar player, take lessons from the very best that you can. If you want to be a singer, take lessons, learn your craft to the best of your abilities. You have to know the craft. And if it's singing, that's what you need to learn. If it's playing an instrument, you need to do that. If you want to be an auto mechanic, you need to learn from the very best. Learn your craft to become better at whatever it is that you're doing.
That's so true. Become proficient in it.
Yeah.
With that, we're going to freight train ourselves out of here with your song, track 8 of your album, Song of Praise, The Train.
Yeah. All right.
I said this train. This train is a clean train. I said this train. This train is a clean train. Everybody riding in Jesus' name. Cause this train is a clean train. I said this train. This train has left the station.
Southern Sense here on Blog Talk Radio, SHR Media, SHR Media, High Plains Media, Connecticut Hi-Fi, the Fix FM, out of Charleston, South Carolina. I'm your hostess with the mostest, Annie, the radio chick, and our guest is Doug Briney. He is an award-winning country music star out of currently Nashville, South Carolina, and his album is Songs of Faith. And Doug, how do you keep the parishioners from not dancing in the aisle when you play that song?
Well, I hope they do. I hope they do. I don't discourage that at all. I hope they stomp their feet and get clapping on that.
Well, you know what? We've got some people up in the chat room making comments such as awesome. Sounds like I want to catch this train. You know, so people are enjoying it up in the chat room. So we also have people listening in on the line. I want to say hi to all of them. And my co-host, Cool Mike, is knocking door to door. My ex-co-host, I should say, Cool Mike, is knocking door to doors. So when he gets a break, he may unmute his phone and come on and join us and say hi. Oh, man. Uh-huh. An absolutely awesome, awesome album. People can get it by going to DougBriney.com or just go to Amazon or iTunes and download it. And you must have had a lot of fun doing this album, and you've worked with some fantastic people on it.
I did. I had a phenomenal time doing the album. It was a real joy being involved from every aspect, you know, being able to even pick the musicians that were working on the album with me and talking with them, letting them know what we wanted to do, how I wanted the songs to sound, just, you know, every aspect. It was a lot of fun, and it was a different, you know, each album has been different, a different process, and growing in that process and learning more. And this certainly was the biggest learning curve of all. Had great opportunity to work with people. You Are My King, Amazing Love, was able to bring Mark Allen Cash in the studio, and we did a duet on that one. And Mark, of course, is Tommy Cash's son, who pretty good name in by himself, but he's also Johnny Cash's nephew. And Mark is just a phenomenal performer and a good friend, and on him on the album, and he agreed to be on that, and we had a great time in the studio working on that together. Billy Mason on drums, there isn't a better drummer, I don't think, anywhere in the world than Billy Mason. And him and the Dance Hall Doctors played with Tim McGraw for over 18 and a half years, he's incredible and makes everything sound good.
Doug, you are a big fan of Johnny Cash, right?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Now, did you get an opportunity to meet his sister, Joanna Cash? And if you did, what was that like?
Oh, yeah. I know Joanna fairly well. We've done a number of things together. I've sung over her husband, Joanna Cash Yates. Her husband is a pastor of the Cowboy Church here in Nashville. And the very first time I sang in front of them, I don't get nervous. It's strange, but I really don't get nervous singing and doing performances. I come off an adrenaline after I'm done. I get shakes after I'm done, but just from the adrenaline that dumped afterwards. But I was shaking like a leaf the first time I sung in front of her. And I had a pause, and I says, I feel like I'm singing in front of royalty. But she's a very sweet lady. The entire Cash family is very, very, very generous, very, just, they really are. I can't say enough good about them as a family. They really are. They are the genuine deal. Very caring about people. And it's really been interesting to learn more about a guy that I never did get a chance to meet. I didn't get to meet Johnny, but to learn more about him and who he was. And, you know, Mark tells some stories that are just incredible and about growing up with him. And I'll quickly share one if that's all right.
Go ahead.
This is one of Mark's stories. Him and his dad, Tommy Cash, went over to pick Johnny up one day. They had a meeting in Nashville that they were going to, and of course this was in the days when the phone was on a 30-foot extension cord. You walked all through the house connected to the wall. But they walked over to Johnny's house, or excuse me, they got there to pick Johnny up, and they walked up to the doorstep, and the screen door was open, and Johnny's on the phone, and he motions to him to come on in. And he's on the phone, and he says, yeah, Jimmy, he says, I just don't believe I would do it that way. I think I would do this and this. And he's going through, and Mark's listening to the conversation, and Johnny's walking through the house, winding that cord around all the cabinets and everything else. And he says, Jimmy, I think this would be a much better way to do this, and I really think this is how I would take care of it. Well, Jimmy, I need to get going. My brother is here, my nephew, and we need to get into that meeting in Nashville I told you about. All right. Yeah, Mr. President, you have a good day, and we'll talk to you later. And he hangs up the phone. He was on the phone with Jimmy Carter during the Carter administration. Now, that's in and by itself is pretty cool, but that doesn't show you the importance of the guy. So they're on their way into Nashville, and it's raining, cats and dogs. And Johnny shouts to Tommy, Tommy, pull it over. And he pulls the car over, and Johnny jumps out of the car, and there's a homeless man sitting there up against the wall, just being dumped on in the rain and just kind of sitting there with his head down. And Johnny walks over to the guy, sits down on the curb with him, sits down on the sidewalk with this guy and starts talking to him. Spends about 15 minutes just getting soaked. You know, of course he pulls his black jacket off, and he, as he stands up, he pulls the jacket off, gives it to the guy, reaches in his back pocket, pulls out $100 bill, gives it to him. He gets back to the car. He says, all right, let's go. He says, that guy needed that a lot more than I do. Now, 15 minutes earlier, he was giving advice to the President of the United States, and now he is helping a homeless man alongside the road. He's not, and the whole point of that story is he wasn't so much a respecter of position or person. He was a people person. He loved people. And, you know, those are the kind of stories that I wish we could hear more of, about today's artists doing things like that. And, you know, to have that ability to sit down with the Cash family and know that that is a real, that's the real deal. That's who he was as a person. And it's remarkable. And at the same time, the Cash family, the Cash family will tell you the movie Walk the Line was very kind to Johnny. In his time where he was high and where he was drinking, he was a lot honorier than what that movie showed, but they will tell you that movie was very accurate and very good. Cause it was one of the questions I had, you know, how much of that was Hollywood. And they said, you know, it really was very, very accurate. If anything, they were very kind to him.
One of my favorite movies.
Yeah. But it's remarkable to be able to sit down with some of these people. Some of the shows that I've been able to do, and I spoke of Randy Travis. I've had the opportunity to meet him twice now, and give him the CD, this brand new CD. He was able to give that to him personally, and let him know what an influence that he has been. So the opportunities since I've been here just have been remarkable. That I never would have had those type of opportunities in Alaska, and you know, so grateful for that.
You know, God had a plan for you, and hopefully we're helping him fulfill that plan even here today. You know, it's remarkable that the members of the Cash family are able to carry on his legacy and the legacy of music. And I found it very amazing, and I enjoyed the song Amazing Love, or as people know it, You Are My King. And that's a pretty contemporary song that's only been around for a few years, but it's become so highly, highly popular. And you took the contemporary song because Billy James Toots does it at a slower tempo, and you picked it up, and I felt you made it more joyous with the faster tempo.
Well, we just wanted to make it something that the entire album, we really tried to make something that was fun but stayed true to the song and yet bring everything current. And, you know, I have not heard a country version anywhere. I had not heard a country version of You Are My King, Amazing Love. And That was something we wanted to do, and it's one of those songs that just means an awful lot to me. Every song on here has meaning and is selected for specific purpose. But it was a lot of fun doing this one.
Well, you know, I have in our church.
I love Mark's voice. Oh, yes. At the very end of this thing, he sounds like a didgeridoo at the end of that. He goes down in the basement on that. It sounds like a didgeridoo. The Australian guitar player, his eyes lit up. He says, "Oh my gosh!" You know, and I can't do the Australian accent quite like he does. You know, he's got the authentic thing. He says, "Oh my gosh, it's just like a didgeridoo." he says, "That's incredible." He was blown away with that. It was cool.
Oh no, I did. I especially towards the end, and I had to go back and go, "Wait a minute, who was this doing the duet with you, and who was playing?" And then I said, "Oh my goodness!" And I said, "Mark Cash, I have to play this one." I do see we have a caller on the line. Just going to ask him to hold on for a second. I want to get this song out there, and I'm going to mention that in my church we have the normal traditional services in the morning on Sundays, and then in the evening we have the youth and the contemporary, and I'm going to give a copy, the one that I downloaded off of Amazon, to the guy that does that, because they do it with a guitar and a keyboard and drums, and see if they can use some of your music in our services. So let's play, it's cut 10 from your album Songs of Praise. It's called You Are My King, Amazing Love, and I love the song.
I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted, you were condemned. I'm alive and well. Spirit is within me because you died, rose again. Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true, and it's my joy. I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I am accepted, you were condemned. I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me. Died and rose again. Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true. It's my joy to honor you.
All Amen. Amen on that one. I got to tell you, Doug, my husband came walking into the room because as I was listening to the song, I was singing a soprano harmony in the background. He's going, "You're singing live in the air. You sound great." And I go, "No, I muted myself." Amen. But I do have a caller in on the line. He wants to say hi. This is, as I can unmute this, my former co-host, Cool Mike. Cool Mike, welcome aboard.
Oh, good afternoon, everybody. Always a
pleasure.
Boy, you've certainly moved up in the world there, Pastor, from serving coffee and a little ice cream there in the shack in Anchorage. Now you're a big shot there in Tennessee.
Well, I don't know that we're big shots yet, but we sure are. You know, God's been opening up a lot of doors, and we're excited for it. We're excited to see where this is going.
I've really enjoyed the music, and we keep praying for your ministry and for its success and its growth. Quick question for you. 5 years from now, with all the blessings that continue, where do you see yourself?
Man, I hope that there's a lot more. It goes back to the conversation we were having a little bit earlier. I hope that I can walk into a cafe and I can walk into some places and a lot more people recognize me and recognize the music. As weird as that is, that's the hope. I still see myself doing this and being out there. I'm hoping to get, you know, bigger audiences and being able to do that. Still see myself making music and enjoying it for as long as I can, Mike.
That's amazing. You know, when Annie and I interviewed you, I still remember you were getting ready to pack up and motorcycle trek down to L.A. And the minute we like said, "Okay, have a good day," you know, whatever. And Annie and I were alone. I said, "That guy's crazy." It's like riding your bike all the way down to L.A. I forgot when I said something like, "Can you?" That's such a long way. And, you know, it's some of the people from Americans for Prosperity, Anchorage, follow your music. So,
I did that ride all by myself, and that was 7,622 miles that I did on that trip. It's funny that you mentioned that because that's my son and I right now. My dad turns 86 this year. And my uncle turns 90, and we're having a family reunion next weekend down in Orange County, California. On July 9th, we're having the whole family together. My two boys were supposed to go with me on this trip, and we were going to drive. And we made the drive last year and spent a week with Dad down there, and we just shotgunned it. It's about a 31-hour drive getting there, and we shotgunned it. Just took turns driving and sleeping. And we were supposed to go again this year, but one of my boys ended up, he took time off to do the mission trip last week, and he couldn't get off another week. So Colton and I are going to do it, and we were talking, we were like, you know what, let's take the motorcycle. So we actually just picked up the bike today that he's going to be riding. I've got my bike, and we're going to take off Monday morning at about 5:30, 6 a.m., we're going to take off, and round trip, this will be about 4,500 miles, so quite a few less than Anchorage to L.A., but we're gonna do a big motorcycle trip here coming up next Monday morning we leave, and then we'll be back in Nashville next Wednesday. So it'll be a lot of fun, but, yeah, do a lot of these motorcycle trips. It's good, but this will be the first big trip for him, so it's a we're going to see how he does. We're going to see if he's got the stamina that his old man has.
Well, you know, unfortunately, Mike's call dropped. So, Mike, if you're listening, and call back in. But you have to send me a picture now of you with the new bike, because I still have the one with the old Harley you had.
Ah, yeah. All right. I will do that. I've got one saved on my phone. I can send that. I'll just text it to you right when we get off here.
So, of course, the next time you come on, I can have you with the new bikes, because I still have the old red Harley from Alaska. You know, it is such a fantastic album, and I have so much fun with it. And people aren't aware that you've won. You are an award-winning artist out there in Nashville. You've got the 2013 Independent Country Music Association Award. For 8 months, you were number 6 at the Roots Music Charts back in 2013. 2014, you had the Music Video of the Year Award. That was for Super Country Cowboy video, if I remember correctly, right?
It was for it was for Unknown Soldier is what that, that video award was for. It was for Unknown Soldier. And did real well with that. Have been blessed, been nominated multiple times. The Artist Guild, the IMEA Awards, the Josie Awards last year I won. Josie Award show won Male Vocalist and then Song of the Year. And up for several this year as well with different organizations, and we'll see what happens.
Well, you know, I have to say, you're making me do something I really don't want to do. I never really had an interest in watching the TV show Nashville, but you made 6 separate appearances on the TV show. Now I definitely have to start watching the show. How dare you make me do something I don't want to do?
When you see me, it's just for a fleeting moment. I had a gal, actually had a gal in Virginia ask me, you know, I watch that show all the time. Where were you at? I said, episode this. I said, if you look real hard, you can actually see me. I've been blessed to be on that program 6 different occasions now. And now last season, I didn't, all the dates, none of them worked out, but I was able to get on last season and thrilled that they got picked up. CMT picked the program up after ABC dropped it. So they'll still be filming here in Nashville. Chip Easton, who plays Deacon, got a chance to meet him and talk with him. My brain blanked. The two girls, Macy's not right. My brain just blanked, and I really apologize. They're friends, and
we all suffer from CRS every once in a while. You know,
man,
everyone wants
every
CRS.
Once in a while. Yeah, it's bad. But the two little girls that are on there, I've had a chance to talk with them a number of times, and I'm hoping that this year I'll be able to be back on there and do a few more shots with them and have that fun.
Well, it would be nice if they could also feature one of your songs on there. That would be great. You know, give you a nice little plug.
That would be a dream come true. That would be incredible to have that opportunity. Just being on there and being around them, it is a lot of fun. You serve as an extra. And what's really amazing is you're on set for 14, 15 hours for that day. And when you see the scene that you've been working on, that scene might be all of 35, 40 seconds long. Maybe a minute long, if it's a really long scene, and you know what goes into that. You know, 14, 15 hours on set for that 45-second shot. It's amazing how much time they spend getting everything just right.
No, that doesn't amaze me, because I can't tell you how many times I know footage of one of my interviews or something I've done ends up on the cutting room floor, and you may be talking to a person 15 minutes solid and you get maybe 15 seconds. I know how that goes.
Yeah.
We have a question, Curtis, in the chat room. Let's ask the question, because a fellow Alaskan is asking you, have you ever attended the bike blessing at the city church in Anchorage, Alaska?
I sure did. I attended that a couple times. As a matter of fact, We did First Baptist Church, Old Hickory here, we did a bike blessing this year. And we did that, and I had called up to a city church, and it was real fortunate. I talked with them, and we went back to the original days when they very first did that and talked through all that process. But, yes, I definitely did the bike blessing. I was a part of that a couple times, and when they moved it down on the Park Strip, and was a part of it when they did it at City Church, and then when they moved it to the Park Strip, I had my bike blessed a couple different times. And we just did our first bike blessing here, and we patterned a lot of that after what I knew from seeing up there. And so, absolutely a part of that.
Because he says he has been at them also. So maybe the two of you have crossed paths. Who knows?
But you were very possible.
Well, you know, you mentioned your First Baptist Church's Old Hickory, and I just want to follow up on something, because I noticed that back in February, you guys had a burglary, And this is really, really heartbreaking because some of your equipment, some of your own personal guitars were stolen. Has anything happened to that? Have you gotten anything recovered? Or hopefully we can get word out on this show so if anyone is listening in that area in Nashville by the old Hickory Church, they can, you know, let you know what's going on, maybe where your stuff is.
The pastor and I, we had phenomenal surveillance video of the guy. He looked directly into the cameras a couple times, and we had phenomenal footage of him. And the pastor and I actually did the tracking down, and we actually found the guy, confronted him. He admitted to it. He brought back. I have a 1898 Wurlitzer trumpet that belonged to my uncle. And a couple clarinets that belonged to my uncle that couldn't be replaced, and was able to get all of those back. I got one of my guitars back. One of them was smashed beyond smithereens, and it couldn't get back. The computer was gone. He had messed with it, and it wasn't salvageable. The camcorders. We got one of the old camcorders back. He didn't even remember taking the newer one. He doesn't know what he did with it. He was so high on drugs when he came through, he didn't even realize that he was in the church. It was a bad situation, but we got a lot of property recovered, but not all of it. I'm still short a guitar that cannot be replaced. It can't be replaced. They don't make them anymore. Number one, that model and the way that they did, and then the company that makes it, it makes more lower end equipment now. And at the time that guitar was, they were for trying to get into the higher end stuff. And so I one of these days I'll replace that one. Got one of the guitars back. Of course, it's scratched and dented, and it's got a lot of marks on it. And it was literally did not have a mark or anything on it. It was a brand new guitar that I had purchased, and I had actually purchased it to give away, and then not able to do that now. I can't give that thing away the way it's all messed up. But So we got some of that back. We know his name. We've turned that over to the police. Vehicle license plate, mother's address, girlfriend's license plate, girlfriend's address, and we've given all that to the police and haven't heard anything. I don't know that they followed up on that at all.
Well, hopefully, something good will happen, and maybe someone listening out there would be able to help you get your music and everything back onto its feet for the church, because it's such a good cause. It helps bring a fullness to any service you have to have the music. It's one thing to sit there and kneel and pray, but when you can bring in the joy that music brings and the celebration of Christ and the celebration of God's love, it unites the whole entire service. It unites the entire congregation. And, the songs you have on your album, Songs of Praise, that people can get from your website, DougBriney.com, or they can go onto iTunes or, the brain fart, Amazon. See? We all have brain farts today. But there's so many good songs to pick from because I really do want to finish off the show with Touch One Life. I want to close out with that one, so I don't want to play that one yet. But there's so many that are favorites. I Will Rise by Chris Tomlin, which is a fairly new song. You do that in a – he has that in a slow, slow, calm – it's a nice song for like a funeral to bring joy to people, saying, hey, listen, we will raise up to God. We will be there. I mean, that's a great song. A Closer Walk, which as I mentioned earlier, is – everyone knows the Patsy Cline and Willie Nelson one. Who harmonizes on that song? I had a question mark on that one.
I did all the harmonies, and then Michael Edsner did a few of the harmonies with me on the really, really, really high harmonies are Michael Edsner, but all the other harmonies are myself.
Yeah, I recognize you, and I realized that you did, put the two lines together. But when I heard the higher, alto tenor voice. I was wondering who that was. It was really great praise. And there is one song that is kind of, it is one of my favorites on your album. And this is the one by Thomas A. Dorsey. No, not Tommy Dorsey, the jazz singer, and not Tommy Dorsey, the ball player. This was a guy that was a preacher, and he was a songwriter. He came to music kind of, he grew up with the blues and the jazz, but he came to Christ a little bit later on. And the song you do is Precious Lord. And when I read the story about that, and then I found on YouTube where he personally talked about how that song came to be, it had me in tears. It really had me in tears. And I'd rather have you tell it, because if I start to tell it, I'm going to start crying.
Okay. Well, he was actually a pretty well-known jazz musician and blues musician, and whenever, and then he got saved and he started doing a lot of gospel concerts and leading revivals and doing different things and doing that. And Precious Lord, he back up real quick. He is considered by most people to be the father of what we now call gospel music. Precious Lord, Take My Hand is really considered the first true gospel song. And the way that came about, him and his wife were expecting their first child. They were married. They were expecting their child, and he was asked to help lead a revival and provide music for this revival. So he left his wife at home and went and was doing this revival. And at the end of the time, a young man came up with one of those yellow telegrams. And as he opened it, it only said, come home now, your wife is dead. Of course, he wasn't sure. They didn't have cell phone communications and everything else in that like we do now. So they made the trip home. And when he got there, sure enough, his wife had passed away, giving birth to their son. It was heartbreaking in and by itself. But then 2 days later, his son also passed away. He became very bitter with God, very angry, very upset, did not want anything to do with God anymore, and decided that he was just going to go back to his life as a jazz musician. And a pastor friend of his said, and picked him up and said, hey, we need to just go on a retreat. Let's get away. Let's do this. And they took off. And he started talking to his pastor friend and saying, you know, how bitter that he was and upset that he was with God and how could God do this? And he's a mean and a vindictive God. And his friend said, oh, Thomas, he says, no, our God is not a mean and vindictive God. He is our precious Lord. When they got to that retreat center, Thomas locked himself in the room that night. Next morning, the words to Precious Lord, Take My Hand had been penned. The first verse really talks about the death and the sorrow. The second verse talks about the hope that we have in Christ. And then the third verse talks about standing at that shore and entering into heaven. And that is the history behind this song. And it is really, the song was written in a pentatonic scale. And that was one of the things I went to the guys. We were practicing. We had made two other cuts of this song, and they were good. I enjoyed them. But I said, guys, I want to go back. Let's do this again. And I want to strip this down. And I want this to be, I don't want all the licks. I want this to be done purely in the pentatonic scale. And they're like, what? And I told them the story behind the song, and they said, okay, let's do it. And so we made that, did this cut, and I said, you know, I really want this bass walking type thing, and kind of explained how I was hearing it. And we put this song together after the first two takes, and just not quite right. We put this together. This was a single take. We just nailed this one once we really got into it, and it was just really interesting. But this is done pentatonic scale, how it would have originally been done, but again trying to bring a little bit more today's sound to it.
Well, this is cut 7 from the Songs of Faith by Doug Briney, and this is Precious Lord.
Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, let me stay. I am tired, I'm weak, and I'm old. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home. In my way, rose tree, precious Lord, linger near. In my life, he's all almost gone. Hear my cry, hear my call, hold my hand,
hold my hand.
Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home. In the darkness, a peace and a night draws near.
Amen on that one.
It is
excellent version. I can see it even actually in the streets of New Orleans, Doug, as you're doing, you know, a funeral dirge for, you know, someone in New Orleans being buried. I can see the whole progression over there, and that is what you invoke. Oh man, it's awesome.
Mm-hmm. I'm telling you.
Well, thank you.
I would like to add that the pentatonic scale is on a piano, at least, is all your black keys. Nearly all your Negro spirituals are played in that key, on that scale.
Yeah, and you can play the all Negro spirituals are based upon the pentatonic scale, and that comes actually directly when the slaves came over and were brought over. The musical scale that they had was not what we have as an 8-note scale, do re mi fa sol la ti do. They had a 5-note scale, Yeah, when you sit down at a piano, if you want to play a pentatonic scale, yeah, if you play just the black keys, you're playing a pentatonic scale. Now you can play it on the white keys or any key as well, but that lays it out very simply for you. So it's a 5-note scale, and all your spirituals are based upon that. Amazing Grace is based upon a pentatonic scale. The story behind Amazing Grace is a phenomenal one. The you know, how he wrote that song and being a slave captain for years, a captain on a slave ship for years, he heard from the bowels of the ship. Oftentimes he would have heard a death dirge being hummed in the bowels of that ship. And when he wrote, when John Newton penned the words to Amazing Grace, he recalled that melody that he would have heard coming from the bowels of the ship, and that's what he used as the melody for Amazing Grace. And then
Amazing Grace, which is so funny because his co-writer on that was William Cowper, who was also a slave trader. He also had a similar history to John Newton, but John Newton later on became an abolitionist.
Correct.
It's an amazing, amazing story behind a lot of this. You know, even when you go to the Rugged Cross, you know, George Bernard was out there preaching back in 1912, and he was being heckled. And from that, he went home and wrote the Rugged Cross. And from
the old Rugged Cross.
When he went to do his and when he went to do his next preaching, it was so rousing that people got so fired up because of this song he wrote, simply because he was heckled previously. And the history, and if you look at how God moved people to create this music, and now how he is moving you to bring it forward to other people, it is an amazing journey.
Yeah, and it's exciting. Excuse me. It's exciting, and again, knowing the history behind these things, wanted to be very true to the history of the songs, and to the not just the history, but to the message of the song, and yet making things current, and without changing it. I didn't want to change the songs. I just wanted to bring them current. And we worked hard at doing that.
Well, it shows in your final product. Now, tell us about Touch One Life.
Touch One Life. You know, if you remember my first album there, It's All Country, six of the songs on that album were written by a gentleman by the name of Pat Kelly, teamed up with Bucky Jones on that album, and they wrote a song on It's All Country. One of the songs that they wrote together was The Man My Dog Thinks I Am.
I love that one.
Bucky Jones and Pat got together, and they wrote this song, Touch One Life. As I was looking for music, I keep in very good contact with Pat. I consider him a good friend, he messaged me one day. He says, "Doug, I know you're looking for some music. I know you've used a lot of my stuff." He says, "I'm pitching, but I'm not pitching hard. You know, if you don't feel like it's right for it, the Gospel Project, this is great." But he says, "Give this song a listen." And I listened to the song, and I absolutely loved it. I called him. I didn't even email. I just called him. I says, "You know, Pat," I said, "I love it. Can you send me the lyrics to this, you know, and send me what you got on this?" And I really started looking at it, but I love the song. You know, it's one thing to talk about our faith. It's one thing to proclaim our faith. It's another thing, like you were saying earlier in this interview, of putting actions to our words. And really, that's what Touch One Life is all about. It's putting actions to our words and getting out of our little safe box and doing something with our faith. And that's what it's really about. My boys and I yesterday went over to a lady in her, she's a widow in our church, and went over to her house yesterday and put in a sink and a toilet for her that needed to be done. And just those acts of kindness, those things that we take for granted, but we have the ability to touch one life through. I may never change the entire world. The line in the song is, I may not be able to change the world, but I can touch one life, and I can make a difference in one life at a time. And so that's what the song talks about.
Oh, it's such an important thing, because people don't realize how their actions really do affect others around them. And if you can use your action to do something positive, then that's the best thing. You know, forget about, you know, worrying about you can rush to that door ahead of the other person. Stop. Hold the door open for that other person. Just something as simple as that could mean so much to an individual. That one act of kindness a day, it could mean a world of difference to someone that just needs that little bit of a lift up. And you do so much of that in your music.
Excuse me.
Of course, this is where our guest goes on a coughing fit. I think we just killed him.
Yeah, I want to say this too. You know, in that when we do those acts of kindness, we do those acts of kindness. This is something that really sticks out to me. We don't do it for the praise. We don't do it for the thank yous. We don't do it for those things. But you know what? When someone does something, there's something missing in our society. Just common courtesy. When someone does something for you, why is it that it has become acceptable to not say thank you? And again, we don't do these things for thank you, but I think that's a part of touching one life as well, is letting them know how much it means. When someone does something for you, to say thank you, to pause and say, you know, I really appreciate you doing this. Touching one life can be on both sides. It's not why we do the things that we do. It's not for that, but it lets us know that we have touched you. And you know, I know myself, I sometimes get tongue-tied. You know, people do something nice for me, and I get tongue-tied. I get so emotional. It's like, wow, thank you. You know, and it means the world. So, I touching one life, it's not just doing the acts, but it's sometimes receiving those acts and being able to say thank you and mean it. We live in such a society where we have people thinking that they're entitled, and I don't understand the entitlement mentality. I don't get it. And again, it's not why we do the nice things, but boy, when someone does something for you, take just a moment to say thank you, because that touches them as well. If they touched you and if they helped you and they impacted your life in a positive way, let them know. That it means the world.
Well said.
It really does. Thanks.
Well, that is.
I'm going to get off my soapbox now.
You know, it sometimes amazes me how I end up touching other people's lives, because something I may have said on air or something I may have done in person, and it takes me back and go, oh, I didn't realize it affected you. And I even had it when I worked as a police officer. Someone would come up to me on the street and say, thank you, I remember you for doing that. And, you know, you just do things that are natural to your own personality. So, you know, I never look for the thank you, and obviously you don't, but, you know, that one moment, that act you may do, can mean the world of difference to someone else. And, you know,
it
folks,
really does.
Just slow down a minute.
I was going to make a comment real quick. My neighbor, who I'm always helping, I help her mother, and she slapped my face the other day and said, you never stick around for a thank you. I says, well, I'll tell you what, she slapped my face in public and told everyone that. I said, set me up with that hot little niece of yours. She slapped my face again. It has been great to catch up with you guys down memory lane, let me tell you.
Well, Mike, thank you so much, man. I appreciate that.
Yeah. Well, we're finishing off the show. I did extend it for a few minutes so we can close off with your show, Touch One Life. I want that to end the show with. Just want to remind everyone, we are going to be back here next week after the 4th of July holiday. I ask you, please be careful out there. There are going to be some nuts on the road. Just take your time to go wherever you got to go. Be careful about the fireworks or whatever else you're doing. Careful. I want you back here next week, safe and sound. We will be back on Tuesday with Florida Representative Mike Hill. We'll be talking about a lot of different issues going on. And Friday, we're going to follow up with the shoot down of Extortion 17, the 30 SEAL Team 6 members that were killed in Afghanistan a mere 13 months before the Benghazi raid. And that will be with the author of the book, Don Brown. So we got a lot of exciting shows lined up. So as we close out, Doug, I want to thank you for joining us. I want to remind people, Doug, that they can find you on your website. It is your name, DougBriney.com. As they listen to the podcast, just look through the description. There's a link to go directly to you. People can get your album, Songs of Praise, on Amazon and iTunes. Also, go through your website. They can get it. And it has been a blast, Doug, and I welcome you back anytime. You know you've got my number now, not the show number, cell phone. Keep them separate.
I've got it. And I will text you a picture of me on the bike. And Annie, as always, thank you so much. And I really appreciate the opportunity coming on with you. And again, thank you to the fans for supporting the music. And I really do appreciate it and look forward to next time.
Well, thank you, and have a safe trip to see your father and your uncle. And God bless you on that ride. So as we finish it is cut 9 from Songs of Faith, Doug Briney, Touch One Life.